Texas. And I am the business development manager for Texas and a few surrounding states. On the call today, we have Michael Sommer, who's the BDR out of the Southeast Territory. We have Adam King out of Iowa. Jeff Charette, who is our head of service for the US. And then Rob Robinson, our director of sales for the Central Territory. Adam King, if you want to take it away from here.
Yeah, thanks, Joe. Appreciate it there. Stole my first slide. I appreciate that. So we have a lot of information here regarding defining a home reading platform. So let's dive right into it with the next screen with our objectives, excuse me. So we're going to begin off by talking about a home reading business and technology drivers. We're also going to discuss expanding radiologist reading environments externally from the hospital to their homes or an alternate offsite location. We're also going to touch on not all home is equal, review use cases that are utilized for remote reading. We're going to touch on guiding factors, including standards and regulations. We're going to touch on approaching display selection. Our intent here is to share economical ideas in addition to technology considerations if someone is going to consider a non-diagnostic display. We're also going to touch on platform options that cover workflow tools to maximize ROI and create a lower risk profile for remote reading. And last but not least, we're going to talk about QA Web Enterprise. Moving on, Joe. All right, the concept of home reading has been growing and expanding over years now as radiology departments have evolved and some of the technology bottlenecks have been addressed. The current COVID situation has brought the discussion to the forefront, but remote reading workflow has existed and expanded over some time now. Before we jump into some of the business and technology drivers that have pushed and enabled a remote reading need, I'm going to send it back to Joe for our first poll question. Joe?
Yeah, all right, everybody. So all attendees on board today, we want to just get a quick read of the room and see what your current strategy is for remote reading. There's going to be a poll that pops up with 4 answers to the question. First answer A would be, we have a home read solution implemented at our facility. B is we do not have home read currently implemented. We're starting to explore the solution, and we hope to get a little bit more information. C is that we have a remote reading solution, but it may lack features, capabilities for reading exams. Or D, you're not really sure and you're just here to learn a little bit more information. So we'll give you about 30 seconds here to answer the poll and give everyone a little bit better idea of where we're at right now. All right, we got about 10 more seconds. If you haven't answered, feel free to select an option and we'll go from here. Okay, wonderful. How about that? So it looks like majority of everyone on the call today does have a home read solution implemented, which is fantastic. We have a few individuals here to learn to understand a little bit more about home reading and telehealth, which is fantastic. So we'll make sure we hit on these pieces and focus a little bit more on that technology. All right, now we're going to hand it off to Michael Sommer.
Thanks, Joe. Hello, my name is Michael Sommer, and I am the business development manager for Alabama, Mississippi, Tennessee, Louisiana, Kentucky, and Arkansas. Prior to 2020, working from home was a luxury, and then came COVID-19. The world shut down, and IT staff loaded up radiologists' workstations and displays in their cars and transported them to the radiologists' houses. Home reading demanded attention. Luckily, since patient interaction is limited in radiology as a specialty, they were their early adopters. Many radiologist leaders that we have spoken to expect a blend of remote reading as well as in-office reading to stay after COVID-19 pandemic is over. With the exception of interventional radiology, most RADs can provide clinical support and remote reading as long as they have a robust workstation at home. But it's not just about COVID. There are other unexpected events that have an impact on radiology productivity, but we can work through those situations if planned. Moving forward. The new generation of radiologists entering the workforce are already used to exploring alternate ways of working. Additionally, with the shortage of radiologists, especially in remote areas, it has become common to offer a full workstation from home as an incentive for new hires by many practices and healthcare facilities. Next slide. So we've covered the why. Now let's talk about the who. Those are three of them. The occasional reading radiologist, and this is the cases when a radiologist reads 1 to 2 cases, maybe over the weekend. Only a few cases may be reviewed or consulted while final reads are dictated and done back at their main location. The flexible radiologist. These radiologists are mostly in the hospital, but prefer the flexibility of working from home to avoid traffic challenges or just to have some work-life balance. This scenario also serves as a fallback should any unexpected volume surges occur by having a radiologist at home with a fully diagnostic reading workstation. The last scenario is a full-time production radiologist that reads remotely. This is relatively common with the consolidation of large radiology groups and growing more with 24/7 reading services. This configuration mimics the hospital setup. To sum it up, more you're reading at home, more robust of a workstation you should have. Next slide. So putting in those scenarios in terms of monitors, these are the typical uses for each, with the understanding there is no set rule for each of the facilities, or each facility may have its own unique consideration. The occasional user could use a clinical review station, which is great for wet reads and cardiology. A flexible user will typically read off a pair of 2 MPs or 4 megapixel displays, since they have fewer cases to review where speed is not a factor and panning and zooming may not be an issue, but would like to have also a QA sensor so they can automatically calibrate their displays where this could be important. And the full production user, which as mentioned, will want a similar setup as a hospital where speed is very important. This will typically be a pair of 3 megapixel displays and or a single 6 megapixel, which would be the same environment as a hospital. Not listed is a MAMO workstation, which we have reviewed during our last Lunch and Learn. And for some reason, if you have missed that session, please let us know and we'll send you a recording. Now I'm going to hand it off to Joe for the next polling question. Next slide.
All right, everybody, we're going to keep you engaged here a little bit. So we have our second question of the day. We want to know how you leverage your home reading at the moment. As the poll pops up, you're going to have 4 options, A, B, C, and D. So how do you leverage your home reading today? Is it A, the occasional on-call usage? B, are you using home reading today for flexible schedule or overflow usage? Are you using it for C, full-time production mode? Or D, are you still trying to find out what works best for your site? Give you about 30 more seconds here to answer the question. share with us what you're working with. All right, looks like we got about 10, maybe 15 seconds left here. Get your answers in. Poll has closed. Okay, so it looks like a fairly consistent split. Looks like maybe half of you are for flexible overflow work. Some of you are using occasional on call, maybe a third are full-time production, and there's still quite a few interested in figuring out what works best. So great mix here. Great to understand what you're doing and how you're leveraging this technology. So we've covered the why and the who. Now let's talk about the how of this. The biggest challenge for years with implementing home read was the limitation of technology capability and the ability to support that technology remotely with your current IT staff. In the last few years, advancement in technology has delivered both smaller PCs and small form factor workstations, as well as docking stations where you can connect multiple monitors to a single laptop. These are all great solutions for home users where desk space is likely limited. And at the same time, laptops make it much easier to support since the end user can throw it in the seat of their car, bring it into the hospital for the IT staff to update and troubleshoot as needed. Whether it be through using small form factor workstations or a laptop, the need for techs to make house calls for PC issues could and really should be a thing of the past. Given the benefit of mobility, let's stay with laptops here for a minute. We see that most of the PC manufacturers today also offer workstation grade laptops, which meet minimum hardware requirements for your typical PACS applications. There's a common challenge though in deploying laptops that connect to a docking station. That's maintaining continuity of the display sequence. Now, display sequence dictates the way images are laid out by a PAT system. Now, most of you probably know this as your hanging protocols. That layout's affected when a laptop lid is closed or opened, or when it's connected or disconnected from the docking station. The constant connect and reconnect also affects the quality assurance or QA and the calibration schedule of your displays, since communication between the display and the compliant software is interrupted from time to time. Another challenge that we found is that the graphics board on a laptop can have some limitations in driving the number of displays at higher resolutions, which is necessary for medical imaging. But again, technology has caught up to this as well. We can address all these challenges now through a Thunderbolt or a USB-C interface. Now, technically, the interface would include a USB-C cable with an external graphics device. This is commonly referred to as an EGF box or external graphics card box. By connecting a laptop via the USB-C to an external graphics card box that has a Barco MXRT video card, as we see here in images 1 and 2, we can drive up to 4 displays off the card while providing access to the clinical workflow tools you're familiar with today. Additionally, we're able to maintain a continuous connection to the QA Web asset management tool and calibration platform. And that's because the EGFX box is essentially a docking station with USB ports for your keyboard or your mice, your dictation microphone or your touchpads, as well as having power and network ports. This means it's always connected to your displays and it's always connected to the network. This configuration highlights the simplicity of installation, and after initial setup, home users only have 1 cable to plug into their laptop. The EGFX box and Barco video card handle everything else from here on out. We're seeing this popular for the radiologists who potentially may have multiple homes that they're reading between, or they split their time between their office and their home. They now have the ability to mirror the same configuration at both sites and just use their laptop as their PC from site to site. Now keep in mind, the laptop display also doubles as a nice workless monitor for your facility. So with this setup, you have the imaging power of a tower with the mobility of a laptop. This leads us into another fun poll question for everybody attending today. We'd really like to understand and know how you support your home reading or remote reading sites, right? So we'll have the poll here pop up in a second. So you currently support your remote or home read using A, professional grade workstations similar to ones used in our hospital or reading rooms. B, we utilize small footprint PCs. C, utilize laptops. D, but we don't know because the radiologists use their own technology. Or E, could use some advice, and we'd love to talk a little bit more about this. So give you about 30 seconds here. We won't call anybody out specifically, but we would like to know where you're at right now in the support of your facilities and your radiologists. Right, we have about 10 seconds left to get your answers in. All right, the poll has closed. Let's see what we're working with. Okay, so it looks like maybe a third of you aren't really sure because the radiologist is using their own technology, and that's completely understandable. We see a lot of that happening today. So you're not on your own there. Quite a few of you are at your facilities are using professional workstations similar to your hospital that you're mirroring at home as well, which is fantastic. And then we do have some small footprint PCs. Okay, great to know. Thank you. So each of the case studies and technology drivers we've discussed can be utilized in many different combinations, but the common driving force that affects the correct display selection can be derived from 5 standard parameters. Looking at the standards and guiding factors, the first general document which outlines considerations is the ACR white paper on teleradiology practice. This white paper refers to 2 specific documents to guide us on appropriate display selection for each type of use case. These documents are the technical standards for electronic practice of medical imaging and the IT reference guide for practicing radiologists. Additionally, it's very important to understand this. If you're reading for the state of New York, regardless of where the radiologist is located, it becomes necessary to follow the New York State Department of Health requirements for primary diagnostic monitors. Keep in mind here, though, the Barco follows and complies with all of these documents through our compliance software, which Jeff Schritt's going to discuss shortly. Now, all these standards, guidelines, and state requirements point to a few key display parameters. First, you have luminance. Second is DICOM calibration. Third is your QA or your quality assurance. Fourth is your pixel pitch and resolution. And finally, although not as common, but if you're reading mammography at home, you still need to take into consideration the MQSA requirements. We'll definitely take a look further into a few of these here in a minute. So apart from achieving accuracy, reading efficiency, and best patient care, these standards and guidelines are very important for organizations in also reducing their legal exposure. This article from Aunt Minnie was written by a professional witness for medical cases, and they listed that one of the 9 ways to reduce legal exposure to PACS problems was to keep a record of your display calibration. This helps demonstrate that the standard of care was followed, as well as your commitment to quality of care. So if you're currently letting your radiologist purchase and maintain their own displays with little oversight from the hospital standards, keep in mind that there is still potential liability here for your facility. I do want to pass it on now to Jeff Charette, who's going to dive into our QA web technology and the online QA systems that we have in place for you.
Thanks, Joe. Great job. So anyways, we're going to talk a little bit about the QA web enterprise and how we bring this all together as far as the quality assurance. Let's talk about QA web enterprise. A little bit about it is Barco introduced QA Web Enterprise in Q4 of 2019, and we formally introduced it into the North American market in July of 2020. The release was the culmination of years of development work aimed at making improvements to the legacy online quality assurance solution by modernizing the security architecture and improving connectivity, as well as making other needed improvements. The QA Web Enterprise solution provides a user-friendly interface that is intuitive and much easier to use. Next slide. This schematic on this slide shows the simplified architecture of the QA Web Enterprise. The elimination of the indirect connection via the old QA Web Relay has made this solution much easier to deploy at small and large facilities, and has dramatically improved the connectivity. The security architecture also uses the latest state-of-the-art security measures. All this provides the ultimate solution for managing your QA for your systems at anywhere and at any time. Now let's look at some of the latest industry trends and challenges. Next slide. Okay, so as the population ages and the cost of care skyrockets, healthcare organizations are under pressure to do more with less. These trends are increasing the demand for cloud-based automated solutions to provide a broad-reaching solution. So consolidations of healthcare enterprises brings new challenges to managing a growing number of medical assets in multiple locations. We touched on regulatory and compliance standards. They're getting stricter in every region, and it is difficult for healthcare enterprises to keep up with the changing requirements. As everyone knows, budgets are shrinking, and there is a demand to reduce healthcare costs while assuring excellent patient care. There are concerns about security and obvious patient privacy, as well as a need to find more efficient ways to do things. There are requirements for oversight, management, and reporting of quality assurance processes for quality standards and audit preparation. And of course, the new way of working in 2020, which was accelerated by COVID, the home read market is expected to continue to grow at a very significant rate. Next slide. Next slide will be a poll question, which Joe will cover.
Yeah, so everybody gets to wake back up again and answer another poll for us. We want to know here, the quality control of remote or home reading displays are at your facility, A, completed by radiologists or users responsible for their own QC reporting, B, with standalone software installed on the workstation and manually measuring with an external puck. C, with standalone software installed on the workstation, but using built-in sensors on the display as well. D, using enterprise software with automatic measuring and managed remotely. Or E, not performed at all. Again, we won't give away who's answering these questions. This is anonymous. So if you'd like to be honest, we'd love to understand where you're at right now. Give you about 15 more seconds to answer the question. All right, the poll has closed. Okay, it looks like quite a few are managing QC through the radiologist as they're responsible for their own QC reporting. Interesting, good to see. Some of y'all are also not performing this at all. We're happy to have a conversation with you after the call today. Feel free to reach out to us. We're happy to kind of dive deeper into this to see how we can support you if necessary.
Thank you, Jeff. Joe. We'll take next slide, Joe. Here are my 5 top reasons why I feel QA Web Enterprise is the best online quality assurance solution available today. First, there is no longer a requirement for any hardware to host a relay connection. This has really made the adoption of QA Web Enterprise much simpler process, and the deployment is a breeze. The systems can now be easily connected, even if you have workstations that are connected on separate VLANs. A VPN connection was required in the previous QA Web server solution and is no longer needed with the Enterprise solution. The elimination of the VPN requirement and the ability for direct connection falls perfectly in line with the need for the home read user environment. And of course, you have enhanced capabilities to adjust policies and use a policy editor tool to easily adjust your policies. And of course, QA Web Enterprise uses today's latest state-of-the-art technology for security with 10 times the encryption level of QA Web Server for all data. Next slide. Let's talk a little bit about application security. First off, there is no PHI collected or stored on QA Web Enterprise. The solution uses 2048-bit encryption. It also uses the latest state-of-the-art AWS security technology and has permanent auditing capabilities. Barco has continuous monitoring of the server to ensure uptime availability. The solution also enforces strong user authentication measures for all users, and all users' activities are logged and tracked. QA Web Enterprise also supports the GDPR security regulation, which is a European standard, and happens to be much more secure than the current US standards. Next slide. We've seen this slide before, but I just wanted to touch on the elimination of the gateway or the relay connection as a, you know, opposed to our QA Web Server, our legacy product. It's no longer required to have that relay. This improvement in QA Web Enterprise has significantly improved the deployment capabilities of this solution and really simplified the hardware requirements for the solution. No external hardware or VMs required to host this solution, and it has significantly increased the connectivity capabilities of QA Web Enterprise over its predecessor, QA Web Server. Next slide. QA Web Enterprise uses a modern, secure, cyber-secure cloud platform, which is compliant with today's privacy regulations. Cloud connectivity means you're always able to update with the latest guidelines and standards as they change from day to day. The QA Web Enterprise is easy to configure and manage with effortless connectivity. And again, no relay or local hardware is required. Next slide. The new solution continues the user's ability for custom policies. You also have the capability to create custom scheduled tasks. QA Web Enterprise also allows for smart notification that allows you to easily manage your install base across one facility or multiple facilities. Next slide. QA Web Enterprise allows the user to adjust and customize their QA policies using the policy editor tool. You also have the ability to assign policies at various levels from global overview or down to sub-department levels. This allows you to completely customize your quality assurance for your entire fleet. Next slide. This next slide, we're going to take a look at custom policies. We're going to look at creating a custom policy, say for the New York area, which has a more stringent QA regulation, say in the rest of the US. Okay, next slide, or next step, I guess. Okay, you can group the New York State hospitals in one organization structure and create a QA policy geared to the New York State regulation, as shown here. And next step. Okay, and then next step. Okay, and then you can simply drag and drop that QA policy in the area that you want the policy to apply. By simply dragging and dropping the policy to that location, the policies are now going to be automatically applied. So it's much more kind of more modernized, you know, with the drag and drop capabilities rather than, say, the older QA web server. Next slide. Okay, so this is a look at the intuitive dashboard for QA Web Enterprise. It has a new unique dashboard, which provides a simplified dashboard, which indicates the current state of your facilities. The dashboard can be customized for your facilities. It allows for an easy overview to track all issues that may be impacting your install base. What this means to the user is you can easily target systems that need your attention in a more efficient manner. Next slide. The new QA Web Enterprise has more modern reporting tool features with filtering capabilities. This allows you to easily find your QA results for specific systems or displays at any time. All reports can be exported to Excel. And one thing I'll add here is that, you know, one of the great things of QA Web Server is that it is cloud-based, and there's no more chance of losing any data. When you connect to QA Web Enterprise, all your data resides on the cloud. So if you have a, say, an example where you have to re-image your workstation, our legacy solution, you would lose the any data that did not get transferred. The new Enterprise, all data gets transferred once it's connected. So there's no chance of losing any data. So next slide. QA Web Enterprise takes the guesswork out of setting the quality assurance frequency for general diagnostic displays. Note, settings can vary per state. Once the displays are registered to the enterprise, the policies are automatically applied. The quality assurance tests are automatic, and most are intervention free. This is possible because of the built-in iGuard sensors in the barcode displays. Next slide. And if you would like to sign up for QA Web Enterprise, this is the you can see the URL in the slide. It's https://signup-qaweb.healthcare.barco.com, and then it'll just ask you for information about you and your facility that you're trying to register. But once you have registered, a member of my sales support team will work with you to get your site set up and provide you with the some of the best practices on the use of the platform. And with that, I will turn it back to Joe.
Yeah, hey, thanks, Jeff. And for all attendees, if you need this website address, I'll give you a couple extra seconds just to pull your phone out, snap a picture of the screen, so that you don't have to try and write it down or remember it on your own either. So we'll just a couple more seconds here before we jump into another exciting poll question. All right. All right, so we're going to follow it up here with the last poll question of the day. We'd love for you to share some feedback with us just so we can continually improve the information we're providing to you, as well as improving the conversation today. So we'll give you a little bit of time here. Let us know if the call is informative, if you still have questions, if you'd like to talk about scheduling an on-site demo for some of the tools or technology we have. If you'd like to discuss more about our compliance software, we're happy to get Jeff's team on board with our pre-service engineers, who are very well versed with this technology and the software platform. So we'll give you about 30 seconds here, provide some feedback, and then we'll get into a little bit of Q&A if anybody has specific questions they would like to post for us, or if you'd just like to leave a note for us to follow up with you. A little bit of time, and then might end a little bit early for you. So we got about 10 seconds left here on the poll. Okay, perfect. So the poll's closed, and we'll actually keep these results to ourselves so we can use it and share it, and then follow up with any individuals who are requesting this moving forward. So I do want to jump in quickly to a Q&A. If you have any questions that you'd like to submit right now at the moment, feel free to put it in the chat box. You know, if you want to put your contact info, we're happy to reach out to you directly. We're here to support you and help you make sure that you have everything necessary to be successful at your site and your facility.
I see there's a question, will we get a copy of this webinar after the meeting? I do believe that an follow-up email with a link to the recording will be provided. So the answer to that question is yes. Again, if there are any questions, you can type your questions in the Q&A, or if it's easier for you in the chat. Let's see, I think we got another one.
Also one question, Jeff, says, is there any QoS solution for non-Barco monitors?
Yes. So with our legacy solution, QoS server or QoS agent, QoS agent can calibrate any display. So you could download our QoS agent, and using an external sensor, you could calibrate your laptop, you could calibrate your external displays that were connected. We don't have that capability yet in our QoS Enterprise. Right now, what we can do with QoS Enterprise is you could download the QoS Enterprise agent, and you could do a compliance check, so it could verify the DICOM compliance of that display. So if you had another vendor's display, and you could use their software to calibrate it, and then you could use ours to do a compliance check, you could do that. But I think for your situation right now, the best solution would be to use our QoS agent, which is from our legacy calibration and QA software. And then you could calibrate anything, as I mentioned. So great question, thank you. And if you have any questions on how to do that, we do have 6 sales support engineers, you know, located through the US and Canadian market. So we have a lot of resources for you to tap into to help you with that.
Is there any additional questions?
I think that was the last one. So yeah, I'm not seeing any indications of any new Q&A.
I thought there was one more. Jeff.
So there is one more?
Well, that question, well, what is the best way to see one of those laptop solutions? And
is that's a great question. Yes, we did.
Would you mind repeating the question?
Sure. The question is, what is the best way to see one of these or those laptop solutions? Is there a demo system set up or anything yet? And the answer is yes. We put together demo kits, which can be ordered. Basically just contact your local Barco sales representative, like Michael, Joe, or Adam. Or if you're outside of the regions they cover, just contact your local Barco sales representative. They can order that kit for you. We can help you remotely. If you do allow us to come on site, we can come on site and help you set it up and do the testing. And you can, do a demo of say pre-COVID. So we have HP laptops that we use, but we can also get Dell laptops as well if you're a Dell shop. Or you can bring your own laptop. That you don't have to use the laptop that we have in the kit. So great question.
Great. Well, we'll leave this open. We'll leave the presentation open here for a couple extra minutes in case anybody decides they have another question or two that they want to submit. For anyone else in attendance who does not have any questions, we want to thank you for your time today. We know everybody's extremely busy, even during the pandemic, maybe busier than ever. So we do appreciate your time and attention today. And we'll try and give you a couple minutes of your afternoon back to go grab a quick bite to eat before you get back to work. So thank you again for your time. And if you'd like to stay for any more questions.
Did you already touch on the
On the gift card. So for everyone in attendance today, we are going to send you a $15 Uber Eats gift card for your time. If for any reason you cannot accept the $15 Uber gift card, please shoot us your name in the chat box. Send your name in and we'll take you off the list. We completely understand that there are rules and regulations around this. So if you cannot accept, we do not want to get in trouble. We do not want you to get in trouble over 15 bucks. So to show our gratitude and appreciation, we'll be sending out a gift card after the presentation today.